Now that the dust has settled a little bit, the GameStop bubble has burst. I think it's a good time to kind of take a step back and reflect upon what's happened and what we've learned. So first, let me start with Robinhood, because Robinhood was the one mainly in the news. And many people have benefited from using Robinhood. It is a fintech company that provides low-cost trading. However, most people misunderstand Robinhood's business model. Most people believe that they are clients of Robinhood, but actually, they're just Robinhood's product. So the client of Robinhood is actually firms like Citadel. So Citadel pays Robinhood for their product, and their product is our orders. And it's as simple as that. And Citadel makes the money by getting slightly better prices and front-running those orders. That is the business model. So it seems a little weird that Robinhood had to intervene, actually not the only firm, and basically stop the buying of GameStop stock. And it's been in the media that the CEO got a telephone call from the NSCC, which basically is the clearing corporation, 3:30 in the morning, asking for $3 billion. So what's going on there? Well, it turns out it's very straightforward. There's a formula that is there in terms of the amount of capital that Robinhood would have to have because certain things can happen. The way that stocks are traded and settled, there's a gap in time. It takes 2 days to settle a stock transaction. So within that 2 day period, there's credit risk. And there's a formula for that. And it looks at kind of the historical distribution and figures out what could go wrong in the 99th percentile. And it's very straightforward to actually do that. And there's another part of the formula that says, well, there's going to be extra capital required if 30% or more of your net orders are concentrated in one name. And that was GameStop. So to me, it's not a surprise that there was a telephone call at 3:30 in the morning. The surprise to me is that Robinhood wasn't doing these calculations in real time. The formula is not sacred. If they've got any risk management whatsoever, they need to be figuring out what the capital requirement actually is. They were blindsided, and it doesn't make any sense to me. We're going to learn more about this, but to me, very straightforward, it is a failure of risk management. So that's number one. So number two, what's going on with GameStop? So it was a bubble, and it was interesting in real time. People are saying this is a bubble. And many short sellers got clobbered on this because they could not basically sustain the shorts. They were just losing so much money. And the stock had wild volatility. Okay, so indeed, what's interesting about this episode is that it was spurred by a Reddit group, Wall Street Bets. And this is what's different than other kind of situations like this, where you've got a large group of people, the so-called small retail investors. Any one of them can't really influence the price, but you put them all together and they can have substantial influence. And in my LinkedIn post, I basically made the case that this was an example of a decentralized hedge fund. So in essence, when you put so many small investors together, you've got the power of an institutional investor. And they did some things that were actually pretty interesting. For example, they realized that their stock at Robinhood wasn't really in their name, and Robinhood was lending it out to make some extra money. So, and this is fairly common in brokerages. The stock is in the brokerage's name, and it's lent out, and the brokerage makes money on that. And you would think it'd be more reasonable if that money is shared with the technical owner of the asset, but it isn't. So they were saying, well, let's put that stock into our name so it can't be shorted. And there was so much shorted out there. It was actually more shares shorted than the float of the stock. And that just invites a short squeeze. And a short squeeze is where people have to cover the short by buying back the stock. There's so little of the stock that their buying pushes the price up very dramatically. The options market also contributed to this. So we saw this wild fluctuation in the price of GameStop. So to me, the interesting thing is the following. For years, the retail investor has been marginalized, that the market's been dominated by institutional investors. However, I think we've seen basically a change. The tide is going out. And the power of the retail investor should not be underestimated. And we've seen that they can exercise substantial influence over prices. Now, it's also true that what happened to GameStop was not just about retail investors. There were many institutional investors doing so-called momentum trading, where you see something going up in price and you continue to buy. And when you do that, it also increases the price. Nevertheless, I do think that we've seen a resurgence in the importance of retail investors. And when you see these deviations from a fundamental value and this wild volatility, you have to ask the question, is the market becoming less efficient? And it could be. So these deviations are obviously unusual. And we've also learned that fake news is not just a political phenomena. It can happen in financial markets also. And with retail investors driving the price far away from what most people think is reasonable, that just invites inefficiency. So the last thing I'll mention is that I think we've learned a lot. So we've learned that Robinhood is not as cheap as we thought in terms of the cost of trading, that Robinhood is making money in other ways, and that basically is taking away from investors. It uses the traditional plumbing of the current financial system. We've learned that retail investors, when they band together, can be a very powerful influence. And to me, when you put this together, it is basically the expected evolution of finance. And that's towards a more decentralized way to do finance, where people are interacting between peers, rather than through middle people, which might be Robinhood as a broker, Citadel as the executing broker, the regulatory body that's run by industry, the DTCC and the NSCC. All of this creates inefficiency. And what decentralized finance, what it promises is something different. These problems are not as severe because there's no two-day delay when you buy the stock to when you actually own the stock. In decentralized finance, when you actually do the transaction, you also simultaneously settle. And a lot of these problems just go away. So I'm excited about this direction in decentralized finance. And I believe that this episode is an example of the importance of this innovation.